We'll call the meeting to order. This is the April 4th meeting of the Yellow Springs Village Council. Was that me, I think? Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Wintrow.
Here.
Hausch.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
McQueen.
Here.
Hempfling.
Here.
Also present are Village Manager Pat Gates, Assistant Village Manager Melissa Van Zant, Planning and Zoning Administrator Denise Swinger, Chief of Police Dave Hale, Village Solicitor Chris Connard, and Matt Reed, Planning Commission Chair.
Hello.
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 Are they?
No.
I think everybody's going to have to get a little closer than normal tonight, please.
Yeah.
Okay. And also, if everyone would please turn their cell phones on silent, please. I would appreciate that. We would all appreciate that. Announcements. I'll start with three announcements. We did get our certified election results from the levy. There were 1,454 votes for the levy, 381 against the levy, total votes cast 1,835. So again, as we said last meeting, we're very appreciative to the community of such overwhelming support for the levy, and we will continue to do well by you and by the citizens. So thank you. Also, we got a letter from Mills Lawn third grade reading center students, and they're doing a PBL project, and they're looking for books. They're going to be doing a book giveaway, and they're looking for like new books for students in grades K to 6 or money donations. And if you're able to help out, bring your books to the Mills Lawn lobby, and they're accepting donations from today through May 4th. And you can drop them off anytime between 8 a.m. and 3:30 p.m. Monday through Friday. And finally, YSI, Xylem, their watermark, which is their foundation, is doing a walk for water this coming Wednesday, April 6th. They'll be walking from YSI to downtown Yellow Springs and back. This is all to raise money for global water relief. 663 million people lack access to safe water supplies. 2.4 billion people lack access to improved sanitation. And 6 kilometers is the average distance walked by millions of women and children to collect potable water. So this is primarily, at least as far as the walk, this is a Xylem event. It will be nationwide at all of their locations, but I am sure that Xylem would appreciate donations for their efforts. As I said, they will go to the Watermark Foundation, which will go to water for worldwide relief.
And maybe a place to leave those donations is the Little Art Theater, because that's where they're going to do their water stop downtown. So they'll be coming from YSI down to the Little Art Theater and walking back out. I had a couple announcements. First of all, I wanted to mention that, and I think at our last meeting, I had said that the Village Inspiration and Design Award for the spring went to the Dharma Center. So the reception is going to be on this Sunday, April 10th, and that will start at 11 at the Dharma Center. And I appreciate the Yellow Springs News highlighting that this past week. I also want to mention April 16th, I've got a lovely poster, is opening day for trails. And Yellow Springs will be participating in collaboration with Xenia Station in Springfield. We will have information booths, bike maps, and also the Yellow Springs Active Transportation Committee is sponsoring a fix-a-thon in anticipation of Bike to School Day, which is on May 4th. So kids can bring their bikes down to the trail. We'll be just right by the Bryan Center to check out bikes and make sure they're ready to go for Bike to School. And the last thing I wanted to highlight is something I mentioned last time. Ohio Health is going to be bringing the mobile mammography and bone density screening to our village. And this is going to be on May 27th from 9 to 5 p.m. And I do want to mention again that if you do not have insurance, funds may be available through the Susan G. Komen Foundation.
Thanks, Brian. Anyone else?
Yeah, I have a couple. Number one, I don't know if everybody's aware, you might have seen some articles in the newspaper, but Central Chapel AME Church is going to be celebrating their 150th year of existence, April through June, I believe it is. And more information will be coming forward and getting in the newspaper. And secondly, I don't know if you noticed, but we had a tour of 40 students from inner city Baltimore and the Maryland Eastern Shore area. They were in town on Saturday, and they worshiped with us on Sunday. And I was surprised how impressed the inner city kids were with a small country community and so forth. And they especially liked Young's Dairy, but they spent the whole day with us. So.
Great, thanks. Anyone else? Okay. Next item on the agenda is the consent agenda. We have the minutes of March 21st, regular meeting, and the minutes of March 24th, special council meeting. It was the council retreat. Can I have a motion to accept?
So moved.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Next, review of the agenda. Is there anything we want to add? I know that Mary Ann, there were a number of items on the table related to Mary Ann's reports last week or at the last meeting. Is anything in particular we need to talk about, Mary Ann?
Well, I submitted it in writing because we are starting work on the glass farm, hopefully, this week. And so I wanted to see if there were any particular questions or concerns council members had. I apologize for the copy. I submitted the copy that had the changes without
accepting
submitted
it.
The wrong copy. But you get the picture. So I would like to have just maybe
we'll put that under old business. Specifically, all that you really want to talk about is the glass farm beaver plan. Okay.
Yeah.
Anything else related to the agenda?
Karen, after Matt gives his report on the Planning Commission, we want to make a nomination for an alternate.
Okay.
That'll be quick.
Anything else?
Did you need to add an executive session?
We do, yes. We do have an executive session at the end of the meeting. To discuss potential litigation with the solicitor present. And Brian, would you please review the petitions and communications?
We actually don't have any.
There were a few on our table, primarily Mary Ann's, related to from the last meeting, which we will be discussing. I think other than some periodicals and things that we normally get, I don't think that there was anything else. So. Okay, so next on the agenda is public hearings and legislation. First, we have Resolution 2016-21 by title only, please.
Yes, this is authorizing an agreement between the Village of Yellow Springs and the Greene County, Ohio Engineer for a cooperative paving program. This is Resolution 2016-21.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Patty, would you?
Yes, this is just the standard yearly resolution that we pass that allows us to participate in the county paving program with a collective bid through the county engineer's office for our streets.
Do we know yet what those streets are?
Oh, I knew you were going to ask me. We do, because Jason told me, but I didn't write them down.
Okay, that's fine. I mean, this is just this is always a good contract, and more and more people in Greene County are getting involved in this, so that helps keep the price down.
Yes.
So at an upcoming meeting, it would be good to have those so people can be prepared. Next, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. I guess I should have asked if there was any discussion. Any discussion? I guess, yeah. Resolution 2016-22.
Title only? Where do you go through the
title only?
Oh, title only.
Yes, this is authorizing the village manager to solicit requests for qualifications for information technology services.
Thank you. Could I have a motion, please?
So
move.
Second.
Patty, I'll let you talk about this one also.
This is the, we talked a little bit about the retreat, about going out to bid for IT services, and while I don't expect this contract to exceed $30,000, which is my spending limit, it could potentially do that. So in order to expedite the process, I would like this resolution to be approved so that we can just continue the flow of moving forward with this. And Bruce has decided that he is no longer wants to hold the contract with the village, and so he is going to stay with us through this process and help us out with it, and then he will not be bidding on it. I do not expect him to bid on it unless he changes his mind.
And is this intended to be a full service contract as we have with Bruce to take care of hardware, software, and internet, email, all of that?
It is, and it's actually I'm incorporating a couple of other things into it. Some regular monthly maintenance as part of like a retainer fee so that we can get regular monthly maintenance on things, as well as an annual report on the system and the operation, that type of thing.
Okay. Any other comments or questions?
Well, Patty, how does this tie into, we had talked about an IT audit?
Unfortunately, I was not able to get a company to do that audit. The company that did Clinton County's is no longer in business. And I was looking around for another one to help us with that. Potentially, we can have whoever gets this contract do a full audit for us. And in fact, part of the contract does say they will make recommendations for the system. Mm-hmm. But it does not tie in Channel 5 or the website, because those are right now different animals, so to speak. And from what I've gathered from speaking to people in the field, someone who wants to do IT, while they may do the website, wouldn't want to do the cable access channel and things like that. So it's something that we can potentially talk to the new vendor about tying in at some future date, but right now the contract doesn't include those.
But facilitating, if we do stream,
streaming,
they will have
streaming
to...
is included.
Okay.
Streaming is in the contract.
Okay.
I have a question.
Or the RFP.
What was the discussion about the audit, and what was the purpose?
One of the problems that we have a lot is we have access to pretty high bandwidth, but there's there have been some issues about what's the balance between security versus letting that bandwidth come into the village to make it easier for Susan to do her job,
right,
with the station and so forth. So there was a recommendation by the community access panel that we do an IT audit just to see how things were connected and what the village needed.
And maybe an audit isn't, to me an audit is basically an assessment of what we have.
Right.
I mean, I think maybe it's a recommendation also as to how we balance, basically what you said, how we balance security with access.
Right.
And so I would certainly expect this company to do that.
Right.
I mean, they would have to in order to know what.
Correct. And the RFP does address security, streaming, all of that type of thing.
Okay.
So it's actually, I kind of stole it from Beaver Creek, but they did an IT assessment 2 years ago and put out an RFP.
Okay.
So.
Any comments or questions from citizens? Seeing and hearing none, we'll bring it back for a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Next is 2016-23 by title only.
This is adopting recommended protocols for operation of Channel 5.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Brian, do you want to handle this one, or should we ask?
Actually, Susan, can we pull you from behind the camera?
Hi.
Hi.
For those in TV land, I'm Susan Gartner, and I've been station manager since May 1st. Did someone have questions?
Well, can you just review just kind of the broad brush of the changes that are being made to the rules?
Okay. So I don't have anything prepared, but I would say that I'm making the changes to align with what has happened since I was hired. Some of the things that have happened is the station, when it was in its heyday, was a very vibrant, busy, lots of volunteers coming in and coming out and working on things independent of one another. It was just a lot of volunteers involved in the station doing different things. And that participation and involvement from the community has very gradually, very slowly shifted over the years. And the hiring of me as a part-time person has also shifted the focus of the station, and that 20 hours, the salary, the slow gradual decline of participation from volunteers has all sort of come together to make a new station that looks different from what it used to be. And I felt that those rules applied to the station the way it used to be and needed to be changed to align with the way it is now. That was my thinking behind making the changes.
And Susan, do you want to highlight kind of operationally, like what are the main things that will be?
So different? One of the things is it's a part-time job. And before, with volunteers, I'm not sure how you would sort of wrap your head around how many hours people did, but it's part-time, it's 20. And so things have to change, like I don't want it to be a 24/7 job, even though it really is a 24/7 job. It's a TV station that's on 24/7. But the expectation of me to come from my home into the station to get a camera for someone makes it more of a 24/7 job, and I wanted it to be very contained in 20 hours. And one of the things that needed to be changed is there is an expectation out there in the village when it was this vibrant station. There's an expectation of someone always being here. That expectation is no more. And calling me at home and thinking that I'm going to leave my home and come to get a camera for someone, that expectation needed to change. So one of the things that needed to change was sort of the policy. When can you get a camera? Of course, the cameras are still available. You just can't have that expectation of now. You have to give me some heads up. And so I wanted to change that to 72 hours. I've thought about that. 72 seems right. Sometimes, because I hit 20 hours by Wednesday night, sometimes I'm still working Thursday, and I take off Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So I really had to think about that. But 72 for now, that seemed about right. That was one of the main shifts in it. It's more like an expectation that needs to be changed. The village expecting this cadre of videographers that are sitting around waiting for some fun thing to film, that's from the past. That did happen. That was there. I volunteered at that time. We don't have that anymore. So the whole station has to, the policies have to change. The village mindset has to change. And the other thing is, in 20 hours, I try to do the government tasks. Those are the lion's share of the 20 hours. And if I have time left over, that's when I try to do this community archiving and showing all the community things that we do, which is really fun, and I really like that part. But the government stuff is first. And so that shift has really changed things. Does that make sense? Yeah.
But you are able, I mean, people, you are keeping new things on, and you are able, it's just mostly if people email things to you,
right.
Is that
it's,
how it works best?
It comes to me in a different way. It's still very filled with community things. If I see something maybe on Facebook, I'll approach the business, like Home Inc., and say, that's a great video, could I put that on the station? So it's just coming in a different way, but it's still a very community highlighting station, mm-hmm. but it just comes to me in a different way than how it used to.
Okay.
So, Susan, besides, you know, kind of clarifying the priorities, it seems to me the only operational change is 72 hours notice if you want to borrow a camera. I mean, is that...
I would say that's one of the biggest ones. maybe I wanted to make sure sort of the hierarchy of who I go to. I've gone to Patty. I think of you and Patty as sort of my boss when there's sort of something that relates, I don't know how to say that, something that relates to the building. And CAP has been, help me figure out where the station is going in the future. That's what I use them for. So I kind of wanted that clarification going in case that there was a difference in the way that was, and I want to make that clear. And the other thing is, I think of myself as Judy, like Judy 2. Judy does things sort of document-wise, and I do things video-wise. But I think of myself as part of you all, and I'm like Judy, and I have an office, and I wanted to make that clear. I wasn't sure if that was the mindset of the station before I got here, but I feel like I'm part of the village government, and I do village government things, and that's most of my focus, and when there's free time, then I do the fun stuff. So I wanted those things in there.
Cool. Okay, great.
Thanks.
Any other comments or questions? Any comments or questions from the community? Thank you very much, Susan. Yeah. And you're doing a great job, and you're being very patient, and keep up the good work.
Thank you.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. And the last resolution, before we move on to a bunch of ordinances, is 2016-24, and let's do read this in full, Judy.
This is, well, I'll give you the title, and then I'll hand it to Alyssa to wade through,
because
he's got some particulars. This is a resolution accepting the amounts and rates as determined by the Budget Commission and authorizing them to the necessary tax levies and certifying them to the county auditor. And this comes pro forma from the county.
So basically what this is essentially a very similar document that we receive after we do the tax budget. So they give us the tax rates for the property taxes, and the council needs to go ahead and accept those rates so that they can put those into place. So this is just outlining our 8.4 mil levy that's outside the 10 mil limitation. And they are putting an amount on that of $760,000, and that will begin in 2016 and collections in 2016 to be received by the village in 2017. It will last for 5 years.
Okay. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Any comments or discussion from citizens? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, now we've got, let's start on the ordinances. We'll read these related to Planning Commission by title only, and will Denise be doing the explanations?
Denise will be doing
okay.
the explanations.
So if you want to make your way up, Denise, Judy, would you please read the first?
So it starts with Ordinance 2016-03, repealing old Section 1260.04 uses of Chapter 1260 General Provisions of Title IV, Zoning of Part 12, Planning and Zoning of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Section 1260.04 uses.
Thank you.
Okay.
Denise, you've got a lot of work.
You want to get your motions on that?
Oh, can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, so just start with the first, and then we'll just keep going through them.
Okay, you know, I gave a little bit of history on that, and, you know, the zoning code was completely overhauled in 2013 and has been in practice for a couple of years now. Obviously, we found some inconsistencies in the text, and this is pretty much what this is about, cleaning this up. There is, however, one new thing in here. Zoning Administrator John Young had begun the process, and when I came in, he showed me some things that he was still not finished with, and then Planning Commission and staff has found some new things. So 216-03 is the reason why a lot of these were not passed a while ago, because several of the ordinances five and six, has to do with the accessory
uses and buildings.
Yeah, I want to see if I have this had written down better here. 216.03 is under 12604 uses, which includes the addition of, we're now adding swimming pool regulations for private pools and spas. It removes the required rear yard requirement language to better reflect how property owners use their property. Right now, the way it was written, it if someone wanted to build a garage in their backyard, the way the language reads, you would have to take the setback, and between the setback and the property line, say if the setback's 20 feet and the property line's 50, that gives you a 20 by 50 is 1,000 square feet. You could only build something that's 30% of that. It was just the way the language was. So we're just removing the required rear yard language. And also, one of the things that that council had discovered was there was not consistency between the language for the accessory structures as well as the accessory dwelling units. They weren't both equal. So we're keeping the language consistent between the two, because it could be that an accessory structure would have an accessory dwelling unit in it, such as a garage. And then we also put some specifications in on driveways. There wasn't anything in there in the language about specifically about driveways. So we also put that under accessory. That's 216.03.
Okay. Any comments or questions from council on this one?
On the inconsistencies in the accessory structures?
Yeah.
There were two different things being said. Can you explain what the differences were and which direction? Can you just explain that change?
Originally, the former staff person and planning commission had increased, I believe it was, the accessory structures shall not exceed from 50%, went up to 66% of the principal building floor area, and from 750 square feet to 800 square feet, whichever is less. But then that's fine. But when you get over into talking about accessory dwelling units, that had not been changed. It was still at 50% or 750 square feet. And the problem with that was that you could actually have an accessory dwelling unit in an accessory structure. So it was just keeping everything consistent.
So the space actually went a little larger, it sounds like.
A little bit larger, yeah.
And could you, I mean, the swimming pool thing is totally new. Could you address that a little bit?
The swimming pool is something that the former staff person had talked about with Planning Commission, and then I was asked to go ahead and do some research on it. It's basically, I think the premise pretty much behind it is more about safety, ensuring that there is either a solid cover on a spa or a fence of some sort around a pool so that young children, toddlers, might not wander into the yard and drown. The other part of it was also for people's swimming pools who were not maintained anymore, that didn't become a breeding ground for mosquitoes and other types of things.
Okay.
So it's just making us aware of it. It just gives us a little bit more leverage.
So you're saying before, people did not have to come get any kind of permit to install
an
in-ground pool?
No, and Greene County Combined Health District doesn't regulate it if it's private.
Okay.
The only thing that is regulating, helping with the safety aspect of that, is homeowners insurance. They will pretty much demand
require that you have fences and all, so, okay. Any comments or questions from citizens?
I would like to point out that to make sure everybody is clear, the pool regulation also applies to inflatable pools, correct, if they meet the other requirements?
Well, it's 24 inches.
Yeah,
right. If they meet the other requirements. But
It has to do with depth. If it's 24 inches or less, we don't require this permit.
A lot of people think that inflatable pools, because they can come down in the wintertime, regulations don't apply. So I just wanted to make sure that everybody was clear that they do, in fact.
Yeah, what it's not going to apply to is the wading pool that you have to buy, and yeah.
And does it cover ponds, landscape ponds?
No.
Okay.
No.
It didn't seem like it, but.
It was discussed, but they decided not to
okay.
do that.
Are we ready to take a vote?
Yeah, I have some.
Oh.
It's sort of a process question, I guess. Because I was on the task force that did the revisions, recommended the revisions, and there were things in what was recommended that I was a minority that I was against them. And I'm still against them. And so there are things in the current code that I would like to see changed. And so my question is, are we voting solely on these changes, specific changes, or are we voting on the whole section?
Both.
Yeah, I think you should raise.
Okay, well, then I'd like to raise the issues that I have a concern with. So in the ordinance 2016-03, under uses 1260.04, accessory structures, number two, it says accessory buildings and structures shall not be erected in any front yard. Mm-hmm. I think there are cases where a house is, the main structure is set back quite a distance from the front of the property, and that it could be appropriate for an accessory building to be constructed in the front yard or side yard, for that matter. I guess side yard's okay. And I suggest that should be a conditional use. So that's one.
I don't know. I guess I'm having a difference of opinion. I think this is as a whole new discussion that needs to start with Planning Commission, and I think staff and Planning Commission would probably prefer us approving these as they've been written and only address what's been changed in this particular ordinance.
I will respond to that, and one of the things that is in the code, if that had already been changed, if someone wants to add to the front because their place is set back very far, if they keep within 10 feet that through an attached covered walkway, then that can be built in the front yard.
Okay, well, hear Karen's point, but I guess that there's more than one thing that I'd like to have raised, and I'm fine not raising it now, but I would like then council to have an opportunity to review and maybe talk with Planning Commission. I don't know if there are other things that come up. For example, chickens. I don't think chickens ever got addressed. Mm-hmm. So I think that there are various things in the code that I would like to at least have a chance to say, hey, I'd like for us to revisit this. So I'd just like to for some feedback on the process to use for that, rather than bringing up the specific things right now.
I would like to suggest, since the Planning Commission is talking about these sections and they've thought about it at depth, that if council has something they want to say back, you know, we go ahead and agree or disagree with what the changes are that they recommend, but that Denise take that back, because mm-hmm. why wait?
Right. Oh, I agree with that. I agree, but not.
So
I don't want to hold this legislation.
No, right. I think that's fine. But it was just in terms of, you know, we're looking at it now. Why don't we take a look again if there are things that council wants to raise or?
I mean, I guess what I would ask is how many. I mean, and maybe what this becomes. Maybe we consider having a joint meeting or a work session or something.
Matt's nodding his head, just so you know.
And Matt, does that make sense, Matt?
Yeah.
And maybe so. Maybe that's the approach we take.
A joint session and work session where the council members can look through the code mm-hmm. and also maybe invite citizens who might have some input too. Okay.
Would you have a lot of other things to mention, or?
Well, I have about three or four.
So is it just this particular one, or is it going all through all of these?
Primarily this one, but...
So why don't you just review the sections,
say, okay,
and then we won't
that,
have discussion?
I mentioned one. I think that there should be a conditional use for someone building an accessory structure before they build the permanent structure. And I will just take a moment to say something about that, because there's a tiny house that was built on North Walnut. And it was allowed to be built first, which actually I guess it shouldn't have, but it was. But it was not allowed to be put in the front. It had to go in the back. And because it went in the back and then the primary house went in the front, which is a very tall house, they totally block out all of the passive solar gain that could come from the house that was... Well, it's Nick Boudis' house now. Had, you know, lots of money was spent to have passive solar potential gain on that house. And then when the house was built to the south of it, because they couldn't build their little house there, it totally blocked it. So I think there are times when, well, anyway, I said that. I'm not going to go into the other things because I don't think it'd take too much time. But.
Okay.
I mean, those are valid points, and I think the code then sort of took care of that, because you can't build an accessory structure first anymore.
I know.
Well, and that's her concern. She thinks that there it should be allowed.
Okay. Well.
So yeah, I don't want to delay things by getting into the topic itself, but we seems like we agreed upon a process.
Matt, do you see these as pretty substantive changes?
Yeah, I think it's more discussion.
Yeah. Okay. But we're okay. You think the plan of just going ahead and approving what we're presented with, and okay. So this is an ordinance. We will have two readings and a public hearing. So we'll just take our first vote on ordinance 2016-3. Judy?
Yeah.
Hausch?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Hemphling?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Okay. The next
should
one?
Should we hang on to these papers for the next
Yeah, year? Probably wouldn't hurt.
Okay.
There is one little snafu that Lori Askelin's name is on the back of the roll call.
Hey, you keep forgetting I'm on the council now. I know.
A little nostalgia moment there, but we'll come off next time.
You ready for...
Yeah, the next one. Yep.
This is repealing old section 1262.08, specific requirements of chapter 1262, conditional use requirements of Title IV, zoning of Part 12, planning and zoning of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1262.08, specific requirements.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Denise?
This was one that was noticed when someone wanted to have a home occupation in an accessory dwelling unit as a conditional use, but they weren't allowed to have it in RC. We didn't really understand why RA and RB, but not RC, so we thought maybe perhaps it might have been a text error. We weren't really sure. So that is what
that
part
is
of this
only,
is about.
Oh, okay.
And the other part is what we'd been talking about earlier, the total square feet of the principal dwelling being the accessory dwelling unit being the same, the maximum of 66% of the total living area of the principal dwelling, or 800 square feet, whichever is less. Just keeping that consistent with accessory structures.
Okay, so, you know, similar to what Mary Ann said, I don't want to sideline things. I think we can approve these changes and then talk about others. But I just had a question. Why is a microwave oven required for an accessory dwelling?
That code was written, I've been in the position 7 months, so maybe there's someone else here who
some
might
of these
be able
things,
to answer to that.
Some of these things are state code. Could that possibly be state code, Matt?
I mean, it says microwave
oven.
I think
I can say something.
Okay.
I think that the consultant that we had just sort of boilerplated a bunch of language into this code, and then the task force had to go through and look at it and say, why is this here? So that's, I would suspect that that's, I mean, it, for example, it said you couldn't have a clothesline and some kind of PUD or something, so I would not be surprised if that's the case.
Okay, so I mean, I guess this, I just want to reiterate that I like the idea of a working session. Because, yeah, microwave and a stove, I don't understand why that's a requirement, so that just looks pretty cool.
The microwave might be overkill, but, I mean, there are requirements. The state does have minimum requirements for sanitation and water and cooking and things.
And I think those are good.
Denise is going to go around to all these places.
So maybe we'll just not make it required to have a microwave in the Village of Yellow Springs. Okay, any other questions or comments? Judy?
Yes. Hemphill?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Okay, 05.
Okay, 405. This is repealing old section 1258.01 district uses of chapter 1258 schedule of district uses of title 4 zoning of part 12 planning and zoning of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1258.01 district uses.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
And this is the swimming pool regulation, swimming pool and spas.
Okay. And did I have that in the packet? I didn't. Was there anything in the packet about that?
Yes.
Yeah.
It was online. This is just kind of the, all it does is add that section in.
Okay.
To the color code.
The color code.
Okay. Any other discussion, questions by council? Citizens? Judy, please call the roll.
Yes. McQueen?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Hemphill?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. 06.
This is repealing old section 1470.02 definitions of chapter 1470 public nuisances of title 4 miscellaneous building regulations of part 14 building and housing of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1470.02 definitions.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Denise?
This adds the swimming pool or spa to what is considered a public nuisance. It didn't fit under the other definitions of cellar, well, cistern, mm-hmm. structure, smoke sacks. So we wanted to go ahead and put that in there as well. So it's just adding that swimming pool or spa into that so it can be considered a public nuisance if we do have, if there is an issue, if there is a complaint that, you know, it's an unmaintained pool and there's mosquitoes, we have a little bit of meat to go after and get someone to comply.
Okay. Any comments or questions from council? Citizens? Judy, please call the roll.
Yes. Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Hemphill?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. The last one is that the last one, or do we have one?
2016-07.
07, yes.
Mm-hmm. And this is repealing old section 1284.08 definitions, RS of chapter 1284, definitions of title 4 zoning of part 12 planning and zoning of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1284.08 definitions.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Denise?
This is just adding swimming pools and spas as a definition under that section.
Okay. Any comments or questions from council? Citizens? Judy, please call the roll.
Hausch?
Yes.
Hemphill?
Yep.
Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Thanks a lot, Denise. Uh-huh. That's a lot of work.
Thank you.
And it sounds like maybe it's something you can talk to Planning Commission about, maybe at least at their next meeting, maybe looking at their schedule when folks are going to be in town. I'm not sure when we're going to be able to look at.
Yeah, right now they're working on the sign. The sign code, and that was one section that we felt needed to be looked at a little bit more.
So perhaps maybe, because that will be pretty complicated, maybe before that comes to council, that might be a good time in case there's anything within that sign ordinance that we could do a work session.
I'll we meet next week.
Okay.
A work session on signs?
No, no, not just on signs, but just to review that, but just so that we don't pass that, because I think it's going to be one of the more complex sections we're going to be changing. So we'll just see over the next few months what we can schedule. So thanks, and thanks Matt.
Thank you.
Thanks to Planning Commission.
Karen, if we could back up for just a minute, I want to get this out there so that the folks who don't watch the whole meeting know the question about what streets are being paved. Cemetery Street, Dayton Street from Stafford to Walnut, Keith's Alley, South High Street from the Curve to South College, and Southview are the streets that are being paved this year.
Okay, thank you.
And also 68.
Right. Well, 68, yes, 68 is an ODOT project, but yes, it is being paved as well. The entire length.
The entire length from?
Of the county.
Oh, wow. So that's obviously going to require lots of coordination, coordination with merchants, lots of coordination with events and citizens. So it'll be a big project.
Jason actually called them just the other day and asked them if they had any kind of timetable on it yet, and they said no.
Okay.
So it's actually, they're actually paving more than just Greene County, but.
Okay. The last ordinance on the agenda is ordinance, first reading and public hearing of ordinance 2016-08. Let's just read this in by title and we'll have discussion.
This is amending section 1242.01 of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio.
We need to change that title. We need to appeal the old, I apologize. I have a change for that I thought I had sent out to Judy Friday, but apparently I didn't.
That's it.
But we just need to appeal, otherwise.
So this is, so you're repealing section 1242.01 and adopting a new section 1242.01?
Okay. But I also want to make clear that this is regarding the village electric rate structure. I would like that to be in the title when you're redoing the title. I know, but it's not in the title of the actual ordinance.
Right. Yeah.
Can I get a motion, please?
To move.
Second.
Okay. We will turn this over to Melissa. John Courtney's here, our consultant.
We're going to just let John speak to the changes. This came about as a result of the electric rate study that John did for the village, and then the various rate structures, possible rate structures, went to the Energy Board. After discussion, they made a recommendation for a flat rate structure, which is what John worked on and is part of this ordinance. So we'll let him explain the changes.
I do want to start by saying that the reason this has that this is even on the agenda and that this is being discussed and that we actually hired John to do the rate study is that our electric rates have not changed since 1988, which makes it worse than our water rates and worse than our sewer rates. So. That was the mitigating factor, and also while the electric fund is a healthy fund, we had been noticing a decline, an annual decline in revenues, and well, I don't know, I won't say that there's an annual decline in revenues, I would let Melissa say that. What we're seeing is that we're eating into our reserves.
Right.
The electric fund has always had incredibly healthy reserves, but every year for probably the past 3 or 4 years, we've been eating into our reserves on a pretty significant basis.
Right, and I would like to point out that part of that is because the maintenance on the system was not as diligent as we would have hoped it would be, and the crews are now, for the last few years, have been really working hard at bringing that maintenance onto a regular schedule.
Well, their maintenance, we've added the tree contract where we're actually doing the trees. I mean, so attention to the electric system has been much more significant in the last few years.
Correct.
So, John, sorry, now you can have the floor.
Okay.
Thanks.
I appreciate it. Well, actually, not a lot to say that we didn't say when we were here previously, but as you may recall, we were here back in 2015 when we did the revenue requirement cost service analysis, presented that to you, that indicated that as you just discussed, that the fund reserves were declining and that there was a need to increase the electric revenues to really stop that that decline. The cost of service also indicated that in general, your residential and commercial customers were being subsidized by your large power customers. And so with that, we've developed rates that are going to be reviewed with the Energy Board with Council back in February to kind of address, you know, some of those concerns with the cost of service disparity and also just with the rate structure disparity and trying to bring your rates more in line with the way you incur your costs. And in particular, implementing a customer charge now that you don't specifically have in the old rates for residential and commercial accounts. But phasing that in over a five-year step, so it doesn't hit the, you know, your small users all at once, but it does start to move you in the direction of what the cost of service says you should be doing. So the major changes really are the cost are the customer charges, both in the residential and the in the general service rates. If you recall, you know, we talked about a flat energy charge as opposed to energy blocks that decline. And that's what you have before you is that flat energy charge. We put a provision in to grandfather your commercial rate. Your commercial rate, which really applies to your smaller non-residential accounts, does not include a demand component. And we recommend that you have rates with demand component for non-residential customers. But rather than move all of your commercial customers to that type of a rate overnight, we've suggested grandfathering those existing customers on the commercial rate. They can stay on that non-demand commercial rate. And then having a new general service rate that will apply to all new non-residential customers. Now, if you find, though, a small commercial customer would be better off on that new general service rate, which has a demand component, they could move to that. It would be their option. But it doesn't force your existing commercial customers to move to the general service rate. And then you have the large power rate, which you've always had. The general change there was we raised the demand rate and actually reduced the energy component of the rate slightly to make up for that increase. So, again, the intent to bring that more in line with the cost of service. Probably the key item is what we didn't do. What we didn't do is we didn't change net metering provisions for behind-the-meter wind and solar. I know there was quite a debate about that several years ago, so we left all of that language and all that. The way that you treat behind-the-meter generators is still in place, and we didn't touch any of that, so it basically remains the same. So,
That mean that they get the full exchange?
They get the full exchange, just the way they're getting it now. That's correct. Yeah. I guess maybe I should mention too that we rolled part of the power supply cost adjustment into the base rate. So while these base rates look a lot higher than what you saw in your current ordinance, they're offset by a reduction in the power supply cost adjustment of roughly 3.8 cents a kilowatt hour. So if you're looking at just the base rate comparison, it's going to look like a big increase, but again, a lot of that gets offset by a reduction in your monthly power cost adjustment that changes every month on your bill. That's going to drop by 3.8 cents a kilowatt hour under the new rates compared to what it would have been under the existing rates. So, with that, I'll try to answer questions.
Is the customer charge a totally new charge?
Well, it is specifically, as we identified in the rate, is it's a new charge. But in theory, it was in the old rate. You had a minimum charge for the first 100 kilowatt hours of $10 for residential. And then the first energy block above that was 7 cents. So in theory, you were paying, you know, 7 cents a kilowatt hour for 1,000 or for 100 kilowatt hours. That was $7 and $3 of a customer charge. So, So we've kind of rolled that into a, you know, a $10 customer charge, which a, you know, with a flat energy rate. So,
okay.
You did not have a specific customer charge. You had a minimum charge, and we've kind of converted that to a customer charge. So.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I have several questions.
Sure.
On the first page, where it's talking about the electric service charges, residential electric rate, and then it talks about the bidirectional meter. Is the bidirectional meter only being installed in situations where someone is generating electricity, or do we have that capacity? And
actually right now we don't have bidirectional meters on those. We are trying to move toward that. But yes, that is the intention, is that bidirectional meters be on solar, wind, or geothermal.
Okay, thank you. Okay, on the second page, actually the second and the third page, number four, where it's talking about net rate monthly, do you see that sort of in the middle
yes.
of the page? And then it gives the customer charge, and then it says the single-phase customer charge is such and such. And then right below it, it says the single-phase customer charge. And I'm wondering if that is an error. I wonder if it's supposed to be the three-phase.
That's a typo, yes. That should be three-phase.
I thought we
caught all of those, Patty, but I guess we missed one.
We missed
yes,
one.
And you're correct.
Which one? So on the on the next page, that mistake is needs to be corrected again.
This must be the old one before we.
And fortunately, we traded a few drafts back and forth, and I think some of the changes didn't get caught. So.
Okay, and then the pages aren't numbered, so let's see. The next page after that, whatever page that is, sort of in the middle, E, private outdoor lighting rate. I was not aware that we were giving a special rate for outdoor lighting.
This is all right from your existing ordinance.
Okay, I believe it, but I hadn't seen it before.
Now the new rates are slightly higher than the current rates because they hadn't been changed for some time, but they're still well below what we typically see for these types of services. So
I'd like some explanation. Why is the are people who want to light their backyards getting a break, and why?
Well, I don't know about getting a break. It's not
a break. It's an unmetered service, so you're charging them for the service. There's no meter on this light. It's not coming through their service. It's on a existing pole, typically in the backyard. And it's not a metered light. There's no meter for it. So you charge a flat rate for that service, for supplying the light and the electricity for the light.
So it's not their.
It's not their light. It's
your light. I've got decorative lighting in my house.
Light.
It's not. It's a village light.
That's correct.
That's benefiting a resident, and it's only, even though it may be benefiting multiple residents, only one resident is getting billed for it?
Well, that's typically the way it's set up, but I don't know. I do have some clients, I will admit, that sometimes split that charge two or three ways. I don't know if you have any of those.
I shouldn't have even raised that.
We don't typically recommend that.
Sorry, Melissa.
Yeah.
I mean, if it's a village light, why are we having residents pay for it?
Because it specifically benefits them and not the general public.
Okay, I guess, so if it, my concern is about saving energy.
Mm-hmm.
Our carbon footprint.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not clear why someone would have a light going all night in their backyard or front yard or whatever.
Street light.
At least why they'd get a particular rate for it.
It's more of a, for a lot of people, it's a safety issue or a personal comfort issue, I guess is a good way to put it. Perhaps they have a large piece of property and they want to deter people from coming on their property in the evening. Perhaps they have a shed or an outbuilding in the back that they want to be lit up to deter someone breaking in. I mean, there could be any number of reasons for it.
And do they get a lower rate?
No, it's not a lower rate. Actually, per kilowatt hour, they're paying more because they're paying for the cost of the fixture as well as the electricity.
Okay. All right. It's something that the village puts in?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
At the request, at an individual request?
Right.
Interesting. Huh. And is there a way that we can start to use the motion sensitive ones?
Most
or?
Of them are photovoltaic, I think.
They're photovoltaic, but typically not motion driven by motion sensors.
Yeah. For instance, when my grandmother lived next door to my parents and there was quite a distance between the two residences, we had Duke Energy put one in for safety reasons. That way, if someone had to go back and forth in the middle of the night, you could see where you were going.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was a lightly wooded area.
Would it make sense for the Energy Board to investigate the option of having motion detector kind of thing in those situations?
I don't think that would actually serve the purpose that most people are looking for, because they would rather it be on all night. If it's a motion sensor and it's for safety because you're walking between two buildings, you have to get close enough to it for it to activate. And so I don't think that would really serve the purpose that most people are looking for.
A lot of these are in the apartment complexes and parking lots and such.
Yeah.
I've been hearing comments on Facebook about people in a particular apartment actually paying for a light. So one person in an entire apartment complex is paying for a light.
We had that discussion with those people, and there was...
It wasn't, okay.
There are more circumstances.
Okay, then. It is an interesting situation, though.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions? Thanks, John. Do we have any information on impact? I will say, I mean, a lot of work has gone into this, and I know where staff is coming from, and I understand how long it's been since an increase, but we've had the water rate increases, we had sewer rate increases. There's been a little bit of an anomaly with some of the billing because of the meters turning over, and I'm wondering if we're in just a short period of time for hitting citizens with too many rate increases and not giving an opportunity for them to kind of stabilize and understand, get a feel for where their cost of living is going to be.
But if we keep holding off, and like me on a fixed income, I'd rather know it all now than have to guess what's going to be coming in the future.
Well, we can...
Because I know we've got to increase the rate. You know, that's a given. And to me, almost 20 years, it's
over
a long time.
It's
a long time for not doing anything. And I just,
I think what Karen's talking about is a delay where we still know that it's coming.
Maybe wait till September.
6 months or
give
something.
It, because we will be getting, the second chunk of the water rate increase is going to happen in January, so we don't want to necessarily delay it till January either. But perhaps if we give it a few months so that it's not piggybacking. And again, since it appears that a couple of months of bills will be a little bit non-standard because of the meter turnover, at least give people an opportunity to know where their regular monthly bills are going to be. Because it will... These changes are going to impact people.
So what are you suggesting, that we hold off on?
Maybe wait until revisit it and table it until, say, I mean, August, September.
Well,
we need two readings.
Yeah, we need two readings, and then it doesn't go into effect until 30 days after the second reading. So essentially, you need 60 days to put it into effect, because you need two meetings plus 30 days. The other thing that I would like to point out to council, I do understand everyone's concerns, very much understand your concerns, but two things. We are going to have the second round of water and sewer increases in January, and also this year's budget was based on the projection of the rate increases being in effect for a full year. So just keep in mind that the longer we go without passing them, the more off that budget projection is going to be.
Right. Correct. I'm comfortable with doing it now. I don't know that delaying it a couple months, it might just extend people's anger or whatever their reaction is over a longer period of time.
So when will these take effect? If let's say we do the next two readings, when will these take effect?
June 1. June 8th. May
18th. Can we just go ahead and make it June 1?
We could make it June 1.
Or even...
We could amend it to be
even
June
July
1.
1.
Or July 1.
How about July 1?
Sure.
For the beginning of the second half.
Going into effect.
Going into effect July 1. Is that okay with everyone?
Yeah, as long as we pass.
That's good. So you're going to go ahead and read them and pass it, but with an effective date of July 1.
Effective date of July 1.
So, John, can we...
Is that?
We can change that. Okay. Obviously, we've got a couple other changes that we need to address. So.
Okay. So we'll go ahead and take the vote on this with the change to July 1, and then we'll come back. We'll have some different language, because it looks like, sounds like we have some typos and things that we need to take care of. So Judy, do we have citizen questions? Diane?
Diane Schuster. It's not clear to me what change this is compared to the current rates. I know maybe I'm missing that. John had previously said a 12% increase in residential and 9% overall, I think.
In round number, that's it. Yeah.
And that's the same.
It's the same as what we presented in February, which is the same percentage, yeah.
All right.
Tim, did I see your hand? Okay. Oh, thank you. Anybody else? Okay, we'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yeah, Hempfling.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Wintrow.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, John.
Thank you. Thank you very much, John.
Thank you.
Okay, now is the time in the agenda where we hear from citizens about items that are not on the agenda. We ask that you come up to the podium and state your name and keep your comments to 3 minutes.
Hi, Anna McClure. I'm not sure if this is the right time to ask this question. It might be a little preliminary, but there is a small piece of land, a public right-of-way, that's actually sitting parallel alongside the new bike path along the Birch Edition. The Birch 3 edition. And I was curious if you guys could direct my husband and I as to how we could go about possibly purchasing that little piece of land, if that is even possible.
Where's it at?
It's actually like, we mow it even, but it's like, if you go up Birch Street towards the new Birch 3 housing development, mm-hmm. right where you live, mm-hmm. And there's a small little bike path that mm-hmm. goes right through there.
Yeah.
Well, to the left of that bike path is my house, the A-frame house.
Okay.
The flat roof.
Uh-huh.
And it's just a few feet.
It's actually owned by Sugar Tree Homes.
Uh-huh.
And Chuck Crable is the guy that owns Sugar Tree Homes. He works through Rick Christensen here at REMAX in the village. So I would suggest that if you want to try to purchase that, you get in touch with Rick. Okay. And see if he can talk to Chuck about it.
Great. Glad I asked.
Okay. Thanks, Anna.
Thanks.
Anyone else? Okay. Next, we have special reports, and the Chair of Planning Commission, Matt Reed, is here, and we have a great report in our packet. So, Matt, would you please come up and read everything that's on this report?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So, I'm Matt Reed. I'm the acting chair. I've only been acting for like 3 years, but...
And you're at the acting chair. Who is allowing you to do that?
I've been very good about avoiding this. I've never done this for you folks before, I don't think, at least since the new code. And so I just have some general comments, really, for like the last 18 months. I mean, really, it's been a year of transition for us, or 18 months of transition, with the addition of Denise. I don't know if anyone has any second thoughts about that move, but we don't. It's been a great addition for us. She's been a great help and a great person to work with. So I just want to put that out there. Secondly, we have this new code, and there are lots of things that are still we're finding every meeting. And we intentionally, I think, didn't do the chickens because it was just this massive undertaking, because you start looking at goats and bees, and I think we all just decided to ignore it for now. Okay. But I don't think we should look at it, though, because I know all kind of folks that have chickens. Regardless, so there's a lot of changes, and you are just voted on some today. We've also made some map amendments as well, and work on the sign ordinance, which was a horrible mess, and we're trying to make sense of that. So that's some of the things we're working with respect to some of the changes. A third point is that if you look at the list, and this is something you've seen before from Denise, But if you look at the Planning Commission cases, what you'll see is that a lot of the things we've been hearing are directly attributable to the new code. They're the direct offshoots of intentional changes that we've made. There's lot splits that reflect the smaller minimum sizes of residential areas, A, B, and C. So we're seeing people subdividing and actually building on a lot that prior to this wasn't buildable. We're seeing, construction of accessory dwellings. We're seeing home occupations and businesses and residential districts. We're seeing, and so a lot of what we see just in the last year, they directly reflect the changes we made in the code.
And that's a good thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was done deliberately for a reason, and so we're starting to see, some of the results of that just in our monthly dealings. And then really just one last point is we've also, as a Planning Commission, had a lot of changes. Just 18 months ago, we were four old white guys and Lori Asplund. and it's true, and so now I'm the only old white guy left. And so we've lost some institutional knowledge, but we have new members. We have Jerry, we have Judith as our council reps and alternates. We have, three new members that are energized and really getting into the deal. And so in a lot of ways, with respect to age, with respect to race, with respect to gender, we look a lot more like the village now than we did 18 months ago. And that's a good thing in my mind. So really, that's what I have.
And sadly, we lost Bill Beck.
Yes, that's true. Yes.
So Matt, one thing that's come up is whether Planning Commission should have a hand in. We've been talking about, planning, how we're going to use village land and that kind of thing. And so I'm curious, from your perception, do you think that Planning Commission has the bandwidth to be involved in that?
We may. And I know that I've had conversations with people on Planning Commission, both past and present, that the question of, is there a master plan for village land around the village? Specifically with respect to Glass Farms, when I heard it brought up, but mm-hmm. there's other village land around the village, around as well. We are at your beck and call. If you want us to take that on as a task, we'll certainly give it a go.
Well, the comp plan was updated right before we did we went into revising the zoning code. So, right. Maybe that's the place to start, is for Planning Commission to take a look at the comp plan and see where it stands in relation to some of the things we're talking about. Mm-hmm. Because that is your purview.
Right.
Comp plan is.
Right.
So,
but you're thinking that's sort of the foundation thing to do in terms of thinking about a plan for village.
Right. If we're going to make major changes, I don't believe actually that some of the things we've been talking about really will involve changes. I think most of it is within the comp plan already, but we want to make sure that at least if we're changing things that are in the comp plan, we're doing it knowingly and that we're changing the plan along with it.
And it might be just adding a layer of detail to what's already there. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
Good.
Okay.
Any other comments or questions?
Yeah.
And along with that, we had a little problem getting volunteers, but we finally found a person to serve as alternate. And I'd like, if it's appropriate at this time, to nominate, if that's the right word, Chris.
Zerbukin.
Okay. got her name in as an alternate to the planning. Chris has been in the village over 30 years. She is a previous council member. She wanted me to make sure everybody knew that she was retired now and she'd have the adequate time to work with us on planning.
Can I have a second? Do you have a second?
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Okay.
And I do have one, you know, Matt talks as he's acting, but we actually made it legal. We voted. We right. voted him in, so he is the official chair.
And I do want to thank.
And does a great job.
Planning Commission is doing a great job. Denise, you're doing a great job. I
yes.
agree. And
yes.
and with the projects that I've overlapped with you on, and in addition to doing the planning work, Denise is also doing economic development work. She's attending meetings. She's working on new business opportunities. So she does wear two hats, and she's doing them both very well.
Right, and I would like to add that she just passed her 6 months probation and was released from her probation. And she hasn't run screaming from the office yet. So
congratulations.
All right, thank you.
Okay, moving on to old business. The first item on the agenda is SpringsNet work session preparation. We have the report, their white paper in our packet. I think the thing that we wanted to talk about, I think that council had, you know, definitely is interested in planning on scheduling a work session with SpringsNet. So we need to talk about a couple of things. When in the agenda or when in our schedule that might happen, and also what we want presented, what we want to hear. You know, we've seen the white paper. They've provided links and information on websites and electronically for us to review. So it's now a matter of council kind of distilling what we want to hear and understand about what this fiber network would mean and what we want to accomplish. So do we all have thoughts?
What I want to hear, I started doing a little bit of research. What I want to hear is, well, there's the whole question of sort of the private system competition. Mm-hmm. You know, how it looks like in some bigger places that competition has been, you know, there's been a lot of conflict in a way, and
with commercial providers,
right? I guess I want to hear about. I don't want to just hear that it's good for the village. We know it's good for the village, but the question is, I want to understand the risk, basically, mm-hmm. and you know what would be being asked of the village, and what's the risk. And part of the way to figure that out, it seems to me, is to look at what's already happened out there. And places where there's been problems. I know there's, you know, Brian, you said you guys have had these meetings, but I don't feel like I know that. I want to know when it didn't go so well, what happened,
right.
and
right.
why.
Right.
So we know what, you know, so we have a sense of the risks as well as the benefits. And so, you know, I'd want to hear real specifically about, you know, what's happened out there where it didn't go so well and why, and so that we kind of know. If we're going to go forward, you know, the kind of pitfalls that we need to avoid.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mary Ann, did you have anything specific?
No. Other than I think examining, I'd say maybe a half a dozen communities that have done it that are maybe most comparable to Yellow Springs. I think they indicated two communities mm-hmm. that they had looked at, but I think throwing a little wider net might also then get to what Judith is.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting, if you look at the map, a lot of activity in Kentucky, I noticed, in particular.
I think so. Probably because they're underserved
right.
already. Right. And mm-hmm. that's, I think, there's been a lot of federal money going towards underserved communities.
Yeah. It also looked to me like there's sometimes state laws that can interfere or can encourage this kind of, mm-hmm. you know, direction. So. You know, again, another thing to be better informed about.
Mm-hmm. Jerry?
I think they kind of answered my concern is mm-hmm. that, you know, once we take that leap, you know, would we be abandoned? And then what if we need outside assistance, would that have to come with a big price tag? But unfortunately, I missed the first presentation, so I'm still trying to get up to speed, but that was a couple of my concerns.
Do you want me to go next, or do you want to go ahead?
Go ahead.
Okay, I've got a lot. I just want to see a financial, I said realistic financial analysis. I really want to understand the cost to the individuals and the cost to the village. What's the village investment going to have to be? What's our return on investment? What's the speed of that return on investment? And then obviously, what will each customer pay? I'd like to have maybe a little bit better assessment of the interest in the community than a Survey Monkey. I think we need something a little bit more scientific than that. And who will manage it? I think the whole thing is the Village of Yellow Springs will manage it. We might have some support, so I want to understand the entire operational structure. Who does what from the standpoint of Mavecca, from the standpoint of the village, from the standpoint of our crews, from the standpoint of our billing department, our utility department? Who's going to have to do what? I want to understand the engineering and construction pieces. Is it going on the poles? Is it going underground? Is it a combination? What are the engineering and construction concerns of it on the poles? As Judith said, I want to hear the good, the bad, and the ugly about communities that have tried, that have done this. I want to understand back on the financial model, what happens if the subscription drops, and so somehow we end up with half the customers we had to start with that we're trying to support a system on. Who's going to be marketing? Who's going to market the system? Who's going to get customers? What's going to happen when Time Warner Cable and AT&T lower their rates? Is there a possible commercial partnership? There was a new development, a new commercial development built in is being built in Franklin, and AT&T partnered with Franklin to install wireless for that development. Has anybody talked to the rest of the county? Is there a possibility for a broader county collaboration for this that will get more partners involved and will potentially reduce the cost and increase the benefits? How do we provide tech support? Who is providing tech support in-house when somebody's internet goes out and we get phone calls? How are those calls going to be handled? Who's going to maintain the system? Our electric crews, will there be other people? Will there have to be specialists? Will we have to have special equipment? Let's see. And who, like I said, who's going to market it? Who's going to get the customers? How exactly is that going to happen? And can this be done in phases? Can we concentrate on a really high impact, like doing the intersection of Dayton Yellow Springs and East Enon, where there are some large users and some potential? It's very close to Mavecca, and it could be a low investment for high output. I talked to Hudson. I called Hudson, Ohio. I think that they're going to be an excellent case study. They just had theirs installed last fall. He said they've been I talked to their council clerk, actually. She said they've been working on it for 3 years now. It's taken them at least 3 years to get it up to get to the point of actually installing it. And it was actually based upon the recommendation of their economic development growth group. So it was installed specifically to support economic development. So from that standpoint, I'm obviously excited about the possibilities. So, lots of questions, but certainly excited about, learning more and moving forward schedule-wise. So let's start to talk about...
It seems like there are a number of Ohio communities that have some aspect of it.
Right. And I guess staff. I mean, I'm sure staff has things.
Yeah, I'd like to know if anybody talked to any of the people who currently provide high speed in the areas around us, to see if they have any plans in the very near future to expand out here. Has anybody talked to AT&T to see if they, you know, what their expansion plans are? Has anybody talked to Time Warner to see what their expansion plans are? Because I know that Cincinnati Bell is doing a similar thing called Fi Optics down in Cincinnati, and you can call them and say, when are you going to be in my area? And they can give you an approximate, you know, month or, you know, span of 3 or 4 months when they think they're going to be there. So my question is, if has anybody checked to see if we put this in, are we going to have immediate competition that could potentially affect the financial outlook of that? Because they know what their plans are. They know when they plan to be here or when they don't plan to be here. So.
And I guess actually, I mean, I guess what the next step will be. I mean, it's clearly there's parts of this. I think that there in the white paper there is a recommendation for some kind of a study. I mean, how much? What is that? What does that study entail? What are we going to have to invest to get to the next place? Do we have partners? I mean, can the school system partner with us? Can the township partner with us? To pay for a study? Maybe we can get some private businesses to invest?
And so to that point, since you mentioned the schools, Mary Ann, I noticed in your report that one of the things Stephen said is they wanted to know when we were discussing this, and what was...
Well, I mean, I don't know that he had discussed it with the school board. Mm-hmm. That was just myself and Stephen talking, but... I think he was very interested in seeing it happen.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know,
And being involved in having it happen.
Right. Well, I'll just add a few things. First of all, I guess I want to say I agree that maybe a marketing study could be retweaked. But, you know, I also want to point out that the study that was done, we got well over 300 respondents, and I did a little research, and you know, it turns out, like, once you get up to like 350 people in a study, it doesn't matter how big the pool is of people you're studying, it doesn't really change the results. So I guess I just want to highlight one of the comments in the SWOT analysis: strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, mm-hmm. threats, was analysis paralysis. And I thought that was well stated. I think there are certain things that maybe I'm not convinced we need to spend a lot of time on. On the flip side, I do think the engineering study is really important. And that was something that was recommended in the white paper. I definitely want to understand specifically the role of our village team in this. And this is something, you know, we talked about it. Our retreat is... if we make this a priority, what are going to be the responsibilities of council and village team and then SpringsNet? My understanding is there are some tertiary things that can be done in the short term to see about the viability. And that's where I think the next step is. You know, I think it's just drilling down on, here are the things that SpringsNet needs from our village team. We need that engineering study to explore viability, so we should see how much of an investment that's going to be. And then ultimately, I care about the financing, which, you know, Karen, you've talked about a lot. And, you know, again, what are we looking at? Does the recommendation of a bond issue make sense? What are the other options? I know there are opportunities to do private-public partnerships, so it could be, you know, financed with a private company if we think that's the way to go. So I just don't want to rule it out until we see what those options are. So
I mean, and I agree with you. I mean, I think that there is enough of the village that is interested in this that we could probably have an initial subscription rate. But I do think that there are issues about subscriptions dropping. I think mm-hmm. that there are issues about our rates going up and competitors' rates going down. And what do we do if that happens? So, you know, there's more to, would you be interested in this mm-hmm. than, so I mean, and I really do think, I mean, I'm excited about the idea of this being, you know, maybe going broader, bringing in Greene County Department of Development.
I love that idea.
Because, and I know Fairborn, and Fairborn has a new economic development director, and they're interested. And they were talking, their old economic development director was looking at fiber optics. So I think that, I mean, I'm not saying that we initially go that far, but there are possibilities. So it looks like, I mean, we're going to, it's going to be pretty complex to, not complex, but, you know, we've got a lot of parties to get involved in this work session, because it's going to be SpringsNet, it's going to be all of us, it's going to be our staff, it's going to be SpringsNet, and it sounds like it's going to be at least one or two school board, or maybe we could do a joint school board meeting. We'll let them decide how many of them want to be involved. So, I mean, let's talk about time frame, general time frame, about when we want to tackle this.
There are 5 Mondays in May.
Yeah, but the 5th Monday is
well, that's
Memorial
true,
Day.
It's Memorial Day. That's true.
Unless we want to do the 4th Monday. I mean, Tim, I should ask, I mean, all of these things you heard, is it something that you guys think you would have that quickly?
I think in if you set a date in May, we could definitely be ready. We've talked about almost everything all of you have mentioned so far.
Okay.
We definitely have done a detailed financial analysis. Mm-hmm. And most importantly, the issue of public versus private, we've had a lot of philosophical discussions about that. And right now, we're all strongly on the page of making this a municipal network if at all possible, because there are definite advantages to taking ownership of the project and of the infrastructure itself. It's funny you mentioned Hudson. I just read an article today in Business Tech magazine about the assistant village manager said, as soon as we announced the 1 gigabit service, we got calls from businesses outside the city who wanted in. They wanted to move into Hudson. And I think that is one of the strongest arguments for taking ownership of the network. There are definitely options for a public-private partnership, too, and we're open to discussing that. So I think we definitely could be ready in May, because we got most of this stuff lined up.
Okay. So, Council, do we want to say tentatively the 23rd, May 23rd? I mean, it doesn't have to be a Monday.
I won't be here.
Oh, you won't be here. Okay.
I'm not saying don't do it. I'm coming back.
When are you going to be gone?
And I'll be missing the previous. I'm going to be gone from the 9th through the 23rd.
Okay. I hate to get too much farther into that week, only because people may be taking off for Memorial Day, although, I mean, the 25th is maybe a possibility, that Wednesday the 25th. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think we should definitely all be here. So
let's float out a few dates, and since
can we decide? I did not bring my calendar with
me. No, that's fine. Let's we'll definitely decide. But let's float out a few dates and kind of
send
see.
Them out. And see.
Yeah. Well, and we've got so many to coordinate with. Yeah. I mean, maybe the 27th of June. I mean, I hate to wait that long, but I'm not sure that we. I guess we could do the first week of June.
The 13th.
Is there any need to get the township?
Well,
township?
Denny Powell is involved. Denny Powell, is in SpringsNet, and he's I know he's talked to the trustees.
Okay.
So they're aware of it. I think that they're looking at it as a village-only project and wondering, you know, how far, if there's any way to extend outside the village.
We could invite the township.
I think we should probably. Yeah. I mean, I think this is the kind of meeting we probably should invite them to.
Right.
Which means, well, it won't be on a first or third.
What about May 4th, since Marianne isn't being gone yet? Is that
too May 4th,
soon?
Is that too soon for you, Tim?
No.
Okay, so let's.
Nope.
You're out?
Okay.
Yeah, that's part of my first council meeting that I have to miss.
Oh, so you're out that Tuesday. Whole week?
Yeah.
Tuesday the 31st. It's the day after Memorial Day. Too many people travel.
I think too many people
Melissa's,
travel.
No, it's just usually bad for people that do travel.
I mean, we could really do any time, you know, any time in the middle of May too.
Mm-hmm.
what days, what evenings are best for everybody? If it's obvious, if it's not a Monday, what other evenings?
I can't do Wednesdays generally.
Oh, so you, so the 25th isn't good for you?
Yeah, I'm just realizing. Well, I'm work, every other Wednesday I'm working in the evening.
Okay.
I'm not sure which one.
Do you want me to float out the sort of all the available Mondays in May and then that the additional, just sort of put them all out there and see what kind of response I'm getting back from you folks? And
yeah, I mean, why don't you just, let's, I mean, let's go, let's try to figure out something in May, or maybe even go into the, say, the first week of, well, we probably have to go into the second week of June, only because the first week is going to be that extension of Memorial Day, but, you know, so maybe do May and then the first and second weeks of June. Not Wednesdays, it sounds like.
So
although we'll put it, well, let's go ahead and say May 25th and see if that works for Judith. So is it, is your schedule pretty consistent, though?
It, yeah, it's, yeah.
Okay.
I will know. I just have to bring it along. June 9th is a Thursday.
It's a Wednesday. School board meetings are on Thursdays.
Right, so we can't do a Thursday. Well, what day, which?
Yeah, it's every other. Well, if that May 25th worked, that'd be good. But
yeah, that's, so when, which, the second or the second or the, and the fourth or the first and the third?
I think it's the second and the fourth.
Okay.
Well, the suggestion was let Judy do some research, you know, because we're not only talking about us, we got some other folks that we might want to coordinate with.
Well, there's that, what's that one system that, where you just float out a whole bunch
doodle
of
pull.
Doodle, there's, see if you can find something where you literally, where you can tag a bunch of people and name the dates and the times, and people just click, send it out to a bunch of people and they click on it. That's,
yeah,
that way you won't,
doodle pull.
Yeah.
Are we going to go into June too, possibly?
Yeah, the, maybe the first couple weeks.
That would work.
I mean, that second week of June is obviously going to be pretty tough for me, but I can. Okay. So, any, Tim, are you? Do you have your list of what we're asked, what we're wanting to hear?
Well, I made a list of topics, but you pretty well covered everything.
Okay. Okay.
All your comments.
Do you want to say anything, Tim? Or?
I just really want to encourage, I think this should really happen, and as far as I'm concerned, the sooner the better. But I'll make every attempt to make it work for all of the individuals involved in SpringNet. So, I'm again, schedules are tough, you know, when you're trying to get so many people involved in one place at one time. But I really am excited about doing it, and I think it's a great move for the village. And, I want to encourage all the participation that we can muster, because I have yet to see any recent failures. I mean, everybody mentions Lebanon, but you know, that was in a different time before fiber was even a viable option for them.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't heard of any recent failures, to be quite honest with you. There's been a lot of activity in the last 6 months alone. I mean, major development, and I think the sooner we get it installed here and come bring it to the forefront as one of the first villages in the state to do it, I think we'll get a lot of attention. And yeah, and some of it may be negative, but we've been told that, you know, if a Time Warner and AT&T threatens to do something about it, actually you can turn it around and use it for publicity.
Mm-hmm.
And make an attempt to sell against it. And really, they won't be able to compete with us once we get it installed. We'll be able to provide a service that Time Warner or AT&T can't provide, because we own the poles.
Right.
So.
Okay.
Well, speaking real quick on that, I know we own the poles and so forth, and but I think in our new subdivisions, we're saying everything has to be underground.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so, you know, I know poles are now, but in the long term, if
well, yeah, where there's underground service, the rule we made was where there's an underground electric service, you would probably put in the fiber cable underground as well. And if there's an aerial service, you'd probably service it with, you know, above the ground on the pole.
Okay. But I'm more thinking more in out into the future, you know, will polls become obsolete and then we have to go under?
That's an ongoing argument.
Yeah.
I think there will be polls for quite a while yet.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we've talked about that, and it just, there are just some areas that,
you
first of all, it's
it.
The cost, and there are just some areas. Trees would have to come down. I mean, it would be very difficult for us to bury everything. Everything new's being buried. And everything up to what probably 10 years ago, I think, was buried. Everything starting 10 to 15 years ago was buried. So we're going that direction.
And the one thing that I think SpringsNet needs to know, just in case you don't, you might already know this, but everything is direct buried. Nothing is in conduit. So the electric that's buried in the village is not in conduit, just so you know.
Well, we would just need to know where the electric that's buried is.
Right.
That can be
right. I mean, Johnny had mentioned something about, I guess, when he spoke to someone, and I'm not sure who, that someone had mentioned, like, running it through the conduit, and it's all direct buried. There is no conduit to run it through.
Well, yeah. So, I mean, where there is conduit, we certainly would want to know about it.
Right.
If that's not already known.
Let's not talk about it. If there is anything that SpringsNet needs to know from staff, let's let them have that conversation aside to bring to the work session.
Well, we're meeting with Johnny and Melissa on Wednesday, finally.
Okay.
Have a meeting.
Great.
Thanks, Tim.
Sure.
Thanks.
The next steps regarding possible Glen purchase of a portion of Sutton Farm. I know that there was something in the packet on that, Patty. Something small, wasn't it? Or maybe it was in your report.
The appraisal is in my, that I finally found someone to do an appraisal.
Okay.
Is in my report.
So I think this was just, this was just a placeholder, so we will have it, maybe we'll have it for the next meeting.
You'll have the appraisal for the next meeting. Melissa will be there.
But, and is this a resolution? Or is
Chris.
But does he need legislation? He doesn't need the actual sale obviously doesn't have to happen, right?
No, not for
we don't need resolution until we're farther along the process.
Yeah. Okay. I just want to make sure we're meeting Nick's.
We're talking about Sutton Farm.
Right.
I just want to make sure we're meeting Nick's timetable.
Which I thought was the end of June.
He needs a decision by May 1st.
Okay.
So you'll have to make a decision. It's
so we'll have
meeting.
To make a decision.
Well, that's not a problem.
I mean, the resolution would probably just be an intent to.
Well, but it also has to be clear that we're, you know, that 25% match is
right.
Going to, I mean, they're going to need to know that for the application. So. And that's the whole piece of, you know, selling it at 3/4 of the value.
So we will have to have, and maybe that's something, I mean, that's, you're going to be gone, or maybe it's something you can kind of help to make sure gets ready or gets.
Well, I'll be talking to Nick on the annexation stuff. I can talk to him about that as well.
Okay.
So. Potentially resolution?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And if there's any way he could wait till potentially the second meeting
in May?
I think he has until July 1st to get his application in, so potentially he could, yes.
Okay.
For the actual passage, but we'll ask him.
But we'll keep this on the agenda for the next meeting, just where it is, to talk about the appraisal and see what we're going to do. Okay, next is...
I have a comment about the sale. I think that it behooves us to commit to having a discussion about what we will do with the money that we receive, assuming we do sell the Sutton Farm. I don't think we should just put it into the general fund. I think that we should talk about what makes sense to, for example, one logical thing would be to put at least some of it into the green space fund.
Mm-hmm.
So I just think I'd like to see us commit to having that discussion and making a decision. Not necessarily when we make
when
the ordinance, but that we put that
because
in
place. Because I would like to be present for that discussion as well.
Sure.
So.
I don't anticipate maybe it would be a one-time discussion.
Right.
Either, and people in the community
right.
would be interested as well.
Okay. Anything else on that topic? Next is the follow-up to the Justice Task Force discussion. I believe there was some additional information that you all had provided, you and Judith.
Yeah, we, Mary Ann and I met with Ellis Jacobs and Chris Connard, and, you know, just talked about the task force. What we ended up, well, after that, our, we discussed that, Mary Ann and I had put some more detail. There seemed to be two questions from council. One was, or I think that Chris had mentioned, that we have a little more detail in terms of what, you know, that the committee not get lost in, you know, it's such a broad subject. So we tried to put a lot more detail both in the two areas, one being regarding the current practices and policies, the sorts of things that we would like to have the task force research and then bring that information back to the council. So there'd be, so once that part is done, come back to the council, input would happen from the council, from the community, the mayor, the chief, the solicitor, and then they would go into the next phase of the research that they would be doing, which is about, is looking at these, you know, sort of what possibilities there are in terms of strengthening the institutions, looking at both within, both in terms of, you know, local resources, thinking about that, but also looking outside of the village because there's this big national discussion going on, so that we would look to that. And then I thought there was a question about a time frame, and I wasn't sure what the time frame was supposed to be about. So I added that extra, that second little paragraph, just saying, you know, if council's comfortable with this, that, you know, we would hope that a resolution would come out of this, and then we would put a, you know, ask for applications and, you know, try to seat the task force in a, probably in a couple of months, is what I was hoping.
So are you, you're working on a charge for the, for the task force?
Well, this is the charge.
Okay.
And I think in our goals, it was not as detailed because, but there also was a charge there, you know, in the council.
Right, okay.
And this is just more detail.
And then, I mean, maybe just work with Judy to just get it in resolution.
Okay.
Whoops, in resolution form.
Sure.
Any comments or questions?
I think the detail's good. So, I mean, I think this helps direct the group, so.
One thing that Chris and Ellis, well, they had several comments. I'll speak for them. Chris can add that this, it's biting off a lot. At the same time, it's a pretty cool thing that we're doing, and I think it was Chris suggested that if there were professor or a graduate student at one of the local universities who could get involved in this and maybe do some of the research, and possibly it would fit into that person area of interest or something, that would be good. So I'm saying that now to just sort of get the word out in case anyone thinks of a particular professor or graduate student or even department.
I thought that there was somebody at Cedarville University who had actually written, I think that he may have written an editorial in the Dayton Daily News or something, but his thinking seemed to be pretty progressive in terms of where the direct, at least that's what I was reading, and I could have been misunderstanding, but I think that they have a criminal justice program.
Yeah.
And he has been out, and again, I think it may have been the Dayton Daily News that I saw something from him. I don't know the name. I don't know a name. I don't know.
I can ask.
I don't know about if Wittenberg, you know, Lori might have some contacts at Wittenberg to ask. You know, we certainly have professors at every one of these institutions, so maybe we could, and Chris may have people that he knows at UD. law school or that would be helpful.
Great.
Okay. Thank you. Mary Ann, you wanted to review the Glass Farm Beaver Management Plan.
Yes. So I'm going to, there's a hard copy of the Beaver Management Plan. Actually, what I'm talking about more is the Glass Farm Clean Ohio Grant Activities. Mm-hmm. But Vicki Hennessy developed this Beaver Management Plan, which is a living document, but it includes a lot of natural history about beavers, and I will just pass it along. If any council member wants, or anybody wants, either a hard copy or an electronic copy of the whole thing, I can get that to them. But just to reiterate, hopefully this week, the contractor who's going to be mowing down the invasive pear trees will be coming
mowing?
In to do that. Pardon?
Mowing? Are you serious? They're little tiny seedlings?
It's called it's one of those things that just grinds everything up.
It's a flail mm-hmm. mower.
But they're just little tiny seedlings, though, right? Are they?
No. They're trees.
It's a farming flail mower kind of thing. It'll chew them right up.
Yeah. So, and I met with Jason Hamby today. We have two signs that are going in, one on King Street and one on the Glass Farm near Thistle Creek, where there's some paths that talk about the grant and what's happening. And we did send letters out to let people know that this mowing will be happening, because when that's happening, we don't want anyone on the property. So that's the first activity. A second activity that'll be coming along sometime within the next several months is a small parking area, and I did talk with Jason about that. In terms of the Beaver Management Plan, Vicki, what I've included is that I sent out separately is I think a one-page introduction to that plan, and then this what's called the Beaver Management Task Force. And Vicki has met with Patty, and I think Patty and I have talked about this, and well, we've been talking with Tecumseh Land Trust about it. But the idea is to have a stakeholder group of neighbors and people who want to volunteer for working in this project, as well as some professionals, and to have this be a sort of a pilot project for a year to see how it goes. So this group would do things like assess if there are dams that need to have flow devices in them, if beavers are creating problems somewhere, to examine what's happening and deal with it. I forget what else. I included everything in there. But rather than institutionalizing something like this on an ongoing basis, it seemed like let's try this as a pilot project, see how it works, and then assuming that it does work, we would come back to council probably and say this activity needs to go on in an ongoing basis, and this is how we suggest that it be structured.
And is the task force, what do you call it? Do you call it a task force?
Yes. He's calling it the
Is it a task force of the village?
It would be, at this point, it would be part of the grant activities. So it would be under the Environmental Commission.
Is this manager who I guess is Vicki Hennessy, that a paid position?
No. That is all volunteer.
Okay.
So would the membership of the task force be like advertised the way we ordinarily do for these kinds of bodies? Or is it more of an internal group?
Well, seen as sort of a stakeholder group. So talking to neighbors to find out, to get some neighbors who want to be involved in it. So no, I don't.
Well, no, I think if it's an offshoot of environmental commission and a village council, it's got to be a public body, I believe. Wouldn't it need to be a public body?
Well, one thing that Mary Ann and I had talked about was when I met with Vicki, I suggested that it be a committee or a commission of council. And then Mary Ann called, and she had a few concerns about making it that right away before the actual role of the task force was kind of fleshed out a little bit. Is that correct,
yes.
Mary Ann?
Yeah.
So I think that eventually it does need to be a body of council, but at this point I'm not sure exactly what they're going to be doing. So,
But we've got legal requirements for Chris.
You want to just study the viability of what you want to do?
But we're pulling a group of citizens together under the auspices of the Environmental Commission.
Are they going to be advisory?
Yes.
I mean, technically, you wouldn't necessarily have to make them a public body, but if you're going to go through that process, given how the village likes to do things, then I would do it through legislation. That's how you want to do it. My answer isn't precise because I don't know exactly what you want to do with it yet.
Well, I mean, one thing, it sounds like there's probably resources that you guys know that you want on this body.
Yes.
And the way we recommend to other task force and commissions is you will be the recommender as the liaison to Environmental Commission, right? So mm-hmm. If you want particular qualified people or people that have been really engaged and know what's going on, those are the ones that would be, I mean, if it is a public body, that's a simple way to do it.
Yeah. I mean, and maybe it doesn't need to be as formal as a commission yet, but it does, I would feel more comfortable with it, with the meetings being public. I just think that this is, I think it's enough of an issue in the community, and there have been concerns about the flooding and about the about drainage that I think it really should be a public.
What you could do is you could appoint your, effectively it would be, I guess, for lack of a better word, a subcommittee of some sort, that could be tasked with making a report to the Environmental Commission, which then is the public body that could, it could flow through there, and ultimately the Environmental Commission would then make the report to council. So I think you could just create that ad hoc subcommittee and channel its efforts through the Environmental Commission, and you could notice those meetings. There's no harm in going through the process of noticing.
Right. Here's a concern that I have, and this is an example of something that might need to be done. Let's say the beavers get into the culvert or something, and someone notices, oh, the water's rising. That means, like, the next day, we need to get some volunteers. I mean, I've done it. We need to get some volunteers in there to pull out the stuff that they put in there. Now, that's not the kind of thing that... So this is actually going to be a working, there would be subgroups in this larger group that would be working groups that would come in and do something, and you don't want to have to wait a week to publicize, gee, we're going to pull out some.
But how many people are going to be on the task force? I don't remember. Was there an actual number?
Well, there was a lot.
I think she has, like, maybe 9 to 11 people.
Stakeholders plus, yeah, 2 teachers. So mm-hmm. having a couple of those people get together to pull something out wouldn't be a public meeting.
Right, yeah.
Then, that's so you wouldn't have to notice it if something like that happened.
I mean, anything like that is certainly not, I'm not expecting that to, anytime there's a meeting of the whole group.
Uh-huh.
Right.
And I think just general discussion and general advisory stuff, certainly not tasks and, functions, and although I would assume that those things will be coordinated with staff at some level.
Jason's going to be on the task force.
Okay.
And then I guess if you decide maybe to have a workday of the entire task force, you could just notice that there'll be a workday of the task force at the Glass Farm. If anyone wants to help, they can report it such and such a day or time.
I mean, this is, you know, it's not about having a formal resolution as much as it's about people knowing who's on the commission. I mean, I think we try to be very transparent about who's serving on commissions, make sure they're open, and make sure that meetings are open. And that's what this is about. So what you call it, how you structure it is not what's important. It's just to make sure it's, you know, that it does have an opportunity for public input. Uh-huh. And obviously everything will be coming back to us at some point too,
okay,
for formalization.
So I think I've heard two things. One, that I would come to council with a recommendation about who would be involved.
The members, right.
The members. Mm-hmm. And the second is that the meetings of the whole group would be public meetings, which means that they need to be publicized, whatever that time period is, mm-hmm. the time and the date, the time and place.
Right.
It seems to me, to the extent that it's a kind of a true task force, that that it should be advertised in the paper, and then these people who are interested to be on it, they can certainly apply. Mm-hmm. But maybe there's somebody else that would apply that would be just a real addition.
Right, that you don't know, right.
That you don't know about, and you wouldn't want to. So.
Yeah.
I would think that would make sense just to treat it like a...
Right. I mean, I mean, to me, it's the same work you're going to do in putting together the information for the task force, for the justice system task force. I mean, it's really that process of putting names forward and asking for volunteers.
I mean, partly you're might be looking for particular expertise or whatever, so you're out looking for people to ask them to apply, so...
Marianne, the other thing I wanted to mention is some of the things you talked about might make sense to promote through the village Facebook page, you know, like when the mowing's happening and those kinds of things.
Mm-hmm.
And you're an admin on there now, if you didn't know.
I didn't.
Yeah.
So administer.
Yes.
Yes.
Start putting all.
But it seems like a good way to get some of that out. Like, you know, we're mowing today, you know, don't come out.
Maybe you can help show me how to do that.
I will.
Okay.
You're
next, Judith. Uh-oh. Cool. Okay, well, thanks. That's an amazing amount of work, and it's really exciting to know that that's all coming together.
Yeah.
So good job, and thanks to everybody. Okay, we're on new business, the Tecumseh Land Trust request for funds. They are having their annual harvest auction on
September 16th.
It's up in Springfield at the Holland Beck Bailey Conference Center, and it's always a great event. They have a nice silent auction and great food, and it's a big fundraiser for them. And what they have asked is that we be a sponsor. Their sponsorship levels are range from $100 up to $2,500. And let's see, I think that then Krista is specifically asking for a request or making a request for either $100 or $100 or $250
right.
level.
Red tractor or green tractor. One difference between the two, red tractor, you're listed, green tractor, it's more of like an ad in their brochure, which would mean the village logo.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any comments, or Brian, you wanted a little bit more time to discuss this or to consider it?
Well, I think it's an appropriate request for, you know, what we've put out there for nonprofits, you know, when, you know, our process for what they ask for, and
mm-hmm.
it certainly ties into goals and village values. So yeah, I don't have an issue with that. I guess to me, it's a matter of, you know, how obvious we want our sponsorship to be.
which maybe is the decision between 100 and 250, but I think it's definitely a good thing for us to support.
I think it does point out, though, that I would like to have, we're planning on having a discussion later in the year when it gets closer to budget time about how we are looking at monies that we use to support nonprofits and use to support our goals. And this is one of those that, I mean, I agree with Brian, but I do think we need to have a more formal approach to how we think about it. You know, I'm willing to do this one.
I did want to mention, you know, we've talked about the floodgates, you know, being open. That really has not happened. I mean, when I've looked over the past 2 years, we only got the one request from the Arts Council last year.
Mm-hmm.
This is only the second request this year. I don't know.
I mean, one thing I wondered is, I mean, it's a great cause, so. But I guess just one thing I was wondering is, does it help the cause to have the municipality support it in some bigger way? I just, because sometimes, you know, people are basically, it does help them. It helps them to go for grants or whatever in other instances. So I was just.
I would say definitely yes. I mean, we've had so many grant requests over the past 3 years from Tecumseh Land Trust, and our active support policy-wise has been tied to that. I've seen that in the writing, so I do think that does matter.
Mm-hmm. But again, I think how we choose to use that money towards the goals. I'm not sure if sponsoring an event is. I'm more about, personally, I like maybe an educational program or something else. But this is what we've been given, so I'm more than fine with that. But I'd rather formalize how we're approaching it.
Yeah.
I'm comfortable with the $250 level. Is.
I'll second that.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. What's next? Where's my agenda?
I am.
You are. I'm sorry. Yeah, manager's report.
Melissa, Johnny, and I, annually, we meet with AMP. They come down. They go over our portfolio with us and tell us what's going to happen during the next year that they can predict. They came down last week, and we met with them, and the news is that by mid-May, and I'm looking at all the dates, all of the hydro projects will be online with the exception of Smithland. Smithland has three units at it, and those will go online September 1st, October 1st, and November 1st of this year. That's their projected date. But right now, they are either all of the rest of them, and that includes Cannleton, Willow Island, Meldahl, and Greenup. All of them are online except for Greenup all comes online May 1st. Cannleton has one unit coming online May 11th. And Meldahl has one unit coming online April 11th. So all of our hydros are coming online, and that is going to affect our costs. So over the next few years, you will see that our power costs go up in the budget. Our power costs will go up. A lot of this will be generally offset through our power cost adjustment, which council made the very wise step of making on a three-month rotating basis as opposed to a 12-month rotating basis, and that will help mitigate a lot of the impact that the residents and businesses will feel with this increase. But as these units go online, we will see an impact on that, from that on our power rates. The installation of the new electric meters, we're down to the last few that are difficult change outs or things like that. So we should be done or nearly done, Melissa?
There, excuse me, there are 200 residential meters that are on back order that will not be filled until mid-May. So that's the big holdup.
Right. And those are, we left those for the ones that were like difficult to reach or the residents had some concerns about them. So Johnny's talking to the residents, that type of thing. Streetscape Phase 3 contract has been signed. Work is hopefully going to start April 13th, but that is not confirmed yet. Jason has been in contact with some of the businesses and will continue to be in contact with them as we firm that date up. As part of our ongoing sidewalk repairs, we are going to let an RFP for sidewalk repair for the worst sections of village sidewalks, and Jason is doing an inventory to determine exactly what that's going to be including. Emily Seibel from Home Inc. has contacted me, and they do want to close on the remaining two lots on Cemetery Street, and that will likely happen before the end of the month. And then they plan to start work on both homes simultaneously in May.
So I've got a question. Mm-hmm. So that money that we will receive and that we have received already, that's money simply gone into the general fund?
I believe that's where Melissa's putting it, right?
Yes.
Off of the Cemetery Street mm-hmm. lots, yeah.
I mean, I would suggest that we kind of have it, and I'm not, don't worry about the money that we've already put into the general fund, but sale of village property, I think we should have a separate discussion about where that money goes, mm-hmm. because typically we have that property for a reason. And you know, whether it be green space, whatever it be, so that we just make sure we're assigning those monies in the way we would like to see that money spent.
Well,
wasn't
if this
there,
appropriated,
wasn't there some infrastructure
improvements
yeah. mm-hmm. that we were going to use this to offset?
Yes.
Well, it would have been that would have gone into the water fund then, because
yeah.
it was water.
That's what I
thought. Do you want the proceeds from the remaining two lots to go into the water fund?
I thought that was the idea, but I mean, that was...
Well, can we talk about it?
Yeah, let's...
Yeah, just keep in mind you'll have to talk about it at the next meeting because we will close by the end of the month on these, and so Melissa will
need to know
where you want her to put that okay. money. We have had a couple of incidents in the administrative office recently where someone comes in who's agitated and just kind of barges into an office and gets a little excited and demonstrative with some of the staff. And so to that end, what we have discussed doing in the office is making a large service window in the outer wall there and keeping the door closed so that people can't just walk in. I mean, Ruth Ann was actually attacked by a dog that someone had brought with them. So it's gotten to be more and more of a common occurrence, and we've become a little concerned for staff safety, especially since a lot of times there's somebody in there by themselves. Early in the mornings, I can be in there by myself. Later, Ruth Ann can be by herself. So it just makes sense safety-wise for us to alter the layout a little bit and serve people through a service window like they do at the police department or the utility department.
So when you're back
upstairs
there by yourself,
we're talking about
right, upstairs,
yeah,
down
I,
in Patty's
I couldn't
office.
Figure out, okay,
yeah, yes, I'm sorry, upstairs
yeah,
here,
okay.
yes.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah.
So
yeah.
what if you're back in your office by yourself, mm-hmm. how is somebody going to communicate to you?
They can ring the bell and I can come out.
Okay.
The same as they do now when the door's open. If I'm back in my office, they just ring the bell and I come out.
Okay.
So
there will be a bell mounted, obviously, on the outside.
It's that same bell we use now. There's a bell sitting in Ruth
okay.
Ann's window.
So this is making the area more secure.
Yes, yes.
Makes sense.
The first year of the Clean Ohio Open Space Grant that TLT received on this section of land right here, that outside the window, has been completed. It's gone smoothly, and all of the ailanthus trees have been treated and they're dead, and some that now they can be removed. They have to be dead before they can be removed or they mm-hmm. spread again. And George Beery was kind enough to send us some pictures of some bluebells that are actually native species that are coming back into the area. So those are in the online packet. And we've got another year on that grant, so we'll be moving ahead. There has been an appraiser found for the Sutton Farm land appraisal, and Ohio Real Estate Consultants will be doing that appraisal. They're going to try to have the electronic report to Melissa by April the 15th so that she can shoot it out to council and you can look over it, and then they will give us hard packets, hard copies on the 18th, which is the day of the next council meeting. So hopefully that'll all be ready for you to look at before then. I just got word this afternoon that the OWDA board met and approved our loan on the water plant. So we are now moving, and we do have the funding for that, and we are moving forward. I would like to give a kudos to our crews from over the weekend and all of the hard work they did with all the lovely weather and high winds that we had. Both the Public Works crew and the electric crew were out most of the weekend taking care of things about the village. And today, two members of our electric crew have spent the day working with DP&L because they called this morning saying, can you please give us mutual aid? And Johnny actually just texted me about half an hour ago and said they're finally headed home and all DP&L customers are back on.
Oh, good.
So everybody has electric on this cold, chilly April night. And a reminder to council that I will be out of the office.
And where will you be?
Hawaii. So I have a wonderful house sitter come into my house and taking care of that. And Mike and I will be in Hawaii celebrating our 30th anniversary. And I will send a picture for Judy to put up on the screen at the next meeting.
Yeah. Thank you, and have a well-deserved break. And congratulations to you and Mike, and have a great time. Safe travels.
Thank you.
Before we move on, Patty, so the grass mowing issue is not on your report this time around.
It's with EC, I thought. EC.
Yeah, so that was what I was going to ask. Yeah. So when are you guys meeting next?
We will be meeting...
2 weeks from tomorrow.
Yeah, on the 19th. So we won't have it for the next council meeting, but we will have it at that meeting. We will have a recommendation and we'll send it to council for the first meeting in May.
Okay.
May 2.
Well, it doesn't sound like we're going to be able to change anything this year then.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you. Melissa?
Okay, the auditors were in the building all last week and went over everything. They left early, so that was good. And we should have our audit complete by the end of the month, so I'm anxious to get that. But they said everything looked good, so I'm hopeful for another clean audit. This month's utility bills, we've had some calls from customers, which we anticipated. With this meter changeout program, it was going to affect the bills in terms of when the meters were installed and when they would be read. When the changeout occurred, when it began, it started mid-January or so, and so when those meters were starting to be pulled at that time, we couldn't read them until the system was fully implemented and ready to be read all at once, which occurred on or about March 24th, I believe. So there are some customers that got 2 months worth of bills just because of when those meters were installed and when they were able to be remotely read. So it was just part of the process that was unavoidable. So I just wanted to put that out there that there are some customers that are receiving larger bills, but they kind of tapered off in terms of when those meters were installed because the company that was doing it moved a little bit slower there in the beginning. So we're hoping it's not a huge number of customers, but we've received calls and we've been explaining that to the customers.
But you are working with them to
make
the payments.
We are not penalizing customers again this month if they are not able to pay by the 15th. So we're trying to work with everybody in terms of being, accommodating because we know that that's impacting some folks. but it's not the entire village. It's just those that had their meters put in at the beginning of the project. And then again, we've got about 200 residential customers that still do not have new meters, and they're on back order, and those are still being read manually as we used to do. But this month, I'm really excited about this. This month, we are reading water every single customer this entire month. So the notion of estimated bills and catch-up bills is all going away. So we're going to be able to assist customers in detecting leaks much quicker than what we were able to in the past. It would be 3 months before we would be out to read to be able to notice if there was any kind of an issue. So the quarterly reads are going away as of this month. So that's part of the big bonus to this whole electric meter process. So that's about it.
Great. I would like to give kudos to Melissa and Johnny and the staff of both the utility office and the water crew. They have worked so hard on this project, and there have been some stumbling blocks, but they've worked through them, and they have done an incredible job. And this is going to help so many people getting that bill every month and that read every month and not having that catch-up month. Mm-hmm. I think is going to be very important, especially with the rate increases. That's going to help people to be able to even that out. And I just want to give them kudos from the beginning of, you know, looking for that grant and getting it, and then working through all the problems. They have done a great job.
Thank you.
Yes. So in this context, because a big piece of the discussion around this was, you know, the increases in rates. So we already emphasized that we have not raised our electric rates since 1988. Can we just emphasize for water and sewer?
Do you know
when was the last time?
2005, I think, was sewer.
Sewer, I think, was 2005, the last rate increase.
Mm-hmm. What about water? Do you know? I can't remember.
Well, I mean, water, there was already a plan that was put in place prior to this new plan.
Yeah.
I think it was a 3 or a 5 year plan that was right before this new plan, the new 5 year plan.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Because, yeah, I think that's really important to emphasize is, you know, this has not been done for a long time. And
right.
That this council is responding to this need, so.
Thanks, Brian. Judy?
Well, and I'll add to that, since I seem to use more water than anyone I know, is that now there is the option to go on level billing with water, which is a huge, 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 huge benefit.
Mm-hmm.
So that can help to mitigate some of those increasing costs. I'm looking forward to that immensely, I must say. And then I have a lot of trainings coming up, and I've listed them out for you just to get caught up on things that are required. And they're stated there. That's about it.
Great. Thank you. Let's go ahead and we'll do the future agenda items before we go into executive session. So we'll have the second reading of all of these ordinances. Arts and Culture is making, this is April 18th, and Patty will not be there. So we'll have all the ordinances. We'll have Arts and Council annual report. That's still on.
Mm-hmm.
Arts and Council?
Yep, mm-hmm. Arts and Culture. You arts said it right the first time.
Oh, I did. Okay. Let's see. What did we just say we were going to also
do? Did you want to add
Sutton Farm?
Did you want to add a discussion for use of funds to that? Appraisal return,
yes.
Or as a separate,
yes.
Issue.
Well, yes,
but I won't be here, so I can pass on to Melissa.
Let's not specifically talk about that. The use. I mean, maybe council can throw out some things, but we won't make any decisions.
Are we? We're talking about specifically the Cemetery Street.
Well,
no,
Cemetery,
Sutton.
Cemetery Street,
oh,
and
Farm. Yeah,
and
that can wait.
Farm,
yeah,
that can wait.
Well, we could start talking about our...
Well, maybe we could talk about Cemetery Street, because that's really separate.
Mm-hmm.
And that's coming right up. Right?
Yeah. And so maybe, Melissa, have the number, have the amount.
For Cemetery Street?
Yeah.
It's $21,000 a lot.
Okay. So it's 42. Okay.
Yeah. We just had a new appraisal.
Well, I mean, what I would like to hear is what is, for that one, maybe hear what staff recommends. Get a staff recommendation. If
for,
you know,
Street.
Yes. Would it be helpful for that money to go in the water fund, or would it be better for it to stay in the general fund?
I think it should go in the water fund.
So if that's the case, just bring that to the next meeting with you, Melissa.
Okay.
I think that might be it. I think that might be it. Okay.
I would like to revisit some things about commissions. We talked about them at our retreat, some mm-hmm. things that we wanted to, well, I guess, tell commissions to get standardized. Mm-hmm. And HRC, when we met on our retreat, I think that we came up with some concerns and questions about the new ordinance and whether some other legislation that had been previous is still on the books or not. And I'd like to, I'd be happy to write out like the things that I would like to discuss. Or
so are you saying, do you want to discuss them at the next meeting?
Yes.
Okay, so we'll add that to, and that would
did
be
you put
business.
The justice system resolution
I
task force
yeah
resolution.
I have got it.
Okay, sorry about that. Yeah.
Do we want to also, are we going to review what we talked about, how we're going to action our goals from the retreat? I don't know if that should be on the record or.
Well, that was, it was in the minutes. So it's, some of it was in the minutes. I mean, we can, I can go back and look and see what I wrote and see if there's anything specific that it makes sense to bring, or if you have something that you want to prepare since.
I took notes, so yeah.
Well, yeah, why don't you prepare something okay. then? Okay. Can I get a motion to go into the executive session for the purpose of discussion of potential litigation with the solicitor present?
So moved.
Second.
Wintrow.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Kempling.
Yes.